he who has the most data can then provide the best service. So after that, everything can happen. So, Miha, let's hear your view of Ethereum.
Hello again. One area that I think it's sometimes just maybe not acknowledged is how we are social beings. Social beings, you know, so socializing with each other, making connections, establishing relationships is something natural that just happens. And there is also this aspect of social computation. And, you know, when we get together in groups, we sometimes, you know, sync our minds, so to say, and work on different problems that we cannot solve on our own as individuals. So this is something important to keep in mind when imagining a vision for the future of blockchain or anything, because if it's going to be a good vision, it should somehow enhance or, let's say, put emphasis, or, I don't know, value on the natural traits we have as human beings. So, with that in mind, I imagine that if we look at the progression from Web 1.0, let's say, when you have like the standard of black text on the white background, we then move to the Web 2.0, where you have these kind of social networks and more interactive experiences with people being able to discuss about things, comment on things, like things, share things. I tend to believe that the next wave of innovation that will be made possible by blockchain and introducing the picture, also the ability for these people to self-organize and be able to cooperate and work together on things while not just leaving a comment on Facebook, but being able to actually move resources and coordinate into transforming information that we have on the common into knowledge and action, right? So that, I think that's one of the key areas where if you look at the whole planet as a whole and you have like these global problems, trying to solve them from a centralized paradigm where you know you are counting on someone to just come up with a solution and then you just implement it, it's not easy. And there is this beautiful quote from Carl Sagan that he talks about the pale blue dot, and now we have so many people hitting each other and you know doing bad things for one pixel on the pale blue dot. So I would argue that if we have these decentralization, self-organization, and people being empowered to take action, to coordinate, and collaborate, and managing, making their own little pixel just a bit better, and everyone taking a bit of care on their own pixels, you can have a better pale blue dot.
So collaboration and social base, and just as an example, you know, the world is also moving into augmented reality ways of collaboration, so people can actually see who they want and just drag and drop what you want, how to collaborate, so it's even going there. But it's going even further away, all through voice, spatial. You say, switch on, I'll go to number so-and-so and transact with them, and just voice augmented reality. These technologies exist. These are not future visions that exist today. The only problem is it's not put into the same ecosystem as a system. So, thank you for that.
A bigger picture here, we should look beyond just currency. Like, this is still one of the main investment and currencies and so on. And AI and collective intelligence is this bigger picture. I think if you look again, like 10, 20, 50 years from now, AI can be maybe part of our future. And I don't think we can stop it. But what we can do is to think also, you know, we have this metaphor, which is not really accurate, but I think it's fitting here. We have the left hemisphere of the brain, which is more logical, analytical, and so on. Let's say that's the AI of humanity, as a civilization. But we also need, I think, the SIA, the collective intelligence, this right hemisphere, the creativity, to keep this almighty super intelligence thing that surpasses any individual intelligence in check with our combined collective intelligence, something to benefit us with.
Thank you.